me. We also record our webinars, and you can find it on our YouTube channel at any time. Be sure to spell out Texas Association Against Sexual Assault, and you will find us on YouTube and previous webinars. This one will also be recorded and posted on YouTube probably after the holidays. We'll see. So without further ado, I'm going to change the presenter and unmute our presenters, and we'll get things rocking and rolling. I don't want to eat up into the time, but I'm really grateful to have Amanda and Bronwyn and this ongoing partnership with Texas Advocacy Project. They have been doing a webinar once a month on some really great topics. I think you're really going to enjoy today. They're going to talk a little bit more about their background, but we're very, very lucky to have them with us today. So you'll just bear with me for a moment. We'll do a little computer magic. All right, Amanda Bronwyn, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, this is Bronwyn. Can you hear me, Christine?
I can. How about Amanda?
Hey, this is me. This is Amanda.
All right. I'm not sure which Amanda on here I'm making the presenter, so we may just do a little experiment. One of you is going to be getting a screen sharing option. Wrong one? I think maybe so.
Okay. Let's get this looking pretty for everyone. There you go. How's that? Looking good?
I can't see. Nope, I think, let me do it again. Hold on, everybody. Thank you for your patience.
While they are sharing screens, this is Amanda Elkanic Oder, and I'll just, so we don't have dead air time, just give y'all a little rundown of who we are and who Texas Advocacy Project is. My name's Amanda, like I just said, and the screen that y'all just saw, my title's changed a little bit. It is now the Vice President of Advocacy and Outreach, and I have been with the project for 6 years now, and it is amazing working with the project. I've been working with survivors in a lot of different capacities over the last 13 years. I've done community work, working in domestic violence and sexual assault shelters. I've helped form a couple of sexual assault response teams. I've worked for the Texas Council on Family Violence, doing some legal policy work. And then I get to bring all of that amazing knowledge to the project and get to go across the state to present. I am one of the only non-attorneys that work for the project. And we also like TASA go around the state to provide topics. So if this is something that you're interested in, or if you guys have some issues in your community that you guys would like to see addressed, then we would love to be able to help you along that way.
Okay, we're still unable to see the screen. So I think I've either picked the wrong.
Oh, here we go. You got the right one now.
Okay.
There we go. Yay!
Okay. Someone's already asking if they'll be able to access the PowerPoint.
Yes, we will send out this PowerPoint to everybody after. We'll send it to TASA, and then y'all can send it out.
Perfect.
Okay, everyone. This is Bronwyn again. Amanda, thank you for introducing yourself. My title has also changed here at Texas Advocacy Project. I was a legal director. Now I'm the chief legal officer, and I have been here 14 years. I initially was mainly working with young survivors. I feel very passionate about that. And I'm very passionate about this topic. I think these words, coercion and consent, are really fun to explore the meaning of. And I think society right now is really getting into what these words mean and how the definitions are changing. So I know Amanda is also excited. We're going to talk about several stories kind of ripped from the headlines and break them down and why they're legally interesting and why they're interesting to survivors of sexual assault and interpersonal violence.
So we're going to, let's just give a little rundown. If you don't know who Texas Advocacy Project is, and this is your first time hearing either Bronwyn or I present, we are the statewide nonprofit law firm, and we very specifically only are serving survivors of intimate partner violence, sexual assault, and stalking. And so we have a mighty team of attorneys that has recently grown, and we have 15 attorneys on staff. Is that still right, Bronwyn? I think it's still 15.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Awesome. And then we also have our training and advocacy program as well. And so what our attorneys do, they go, they are able to serve survivors across the state. So last year we were able to serve 13,000 Texans in a lot of different ways, through helping them just understand what their legal rights are. Sometimes survivors aren't ready to take that first move to go and get legal protection, but they just want to know what their rights are. And they may have been told for a long time through coercion that they don't have legal rights, and we want to make sure that they understand that they do and what they are, and that we're here to help them when they're ready to make that next step. So we do direct representation when we can. We offer the legal advice to them. They do, all of our attorneys are just really amazing, and we provide really great services to all of the survivors that need them. In addition to that, we also offer training and advocacy, which you guys are taking part in today. And we travel across the state to provide lots of different training topics. So if you're interested in what other topics we offer, please feel free to reach out to us afterwards. And then we have our community education and outreach, which is our Handbags for Hope, our Backpacks for Hope. And right now we're in the middle of our Hope for the Holidays, where we are sending Christmas presents to 11 families that we served last year. But this is kind of a snapshot of what I just told you. We can kind of skip over it so we can get to the meat of what we're going to be talking about today. But you can see how broad the services are that we provide. And we've served everybody from the ages of 8 to 87 last year. And we were able to reach over 71% of the counties in Texas. And then this, again, just is going over our outreach that we've got. This on here says that we have 13 staff attorneys, but we were able to secure some additional grant funding to be able to hire two new attorneys this past October. So we're really excited to bring them on board and to be able to serve even more survivors across Texas. Okay, so we are really excited to share this presentation with you today on just understanding what those words, those definitions, coercion and consent mean. We've been talking about them for a really long time in this work, but now, as Bronwyn mentioned, the media is kind of using their own scope in defining what those words mean. And so we're wanting to help advocates understand how to apply creative, survivor-centric solutions to these issues in your work and really hone our advocacy skills. So how we can affect changes that increase access to justice for survivors of intimate partner violence and sexual assault. So let's define it. We're going to talk about coercion and consent. We've been talking about coercion and consent for a very long time. So let's go to that next slide if we can. Okay, so how many of y'all, and type in the chat box, have seen this beautiful wheel or a version of this beautiful power and control wheel in any of your time working with survivors? It's been around for a long time. It was created out of Duluth. And what you see on your screen and where this big purple arrow is pointing is where we say using coercion and threats. And what we know when we're working with survivors of intimate partner violence and sexual assault is that coercion plays a huge part in abusers being able to control and maintain power over victims. And so they do that through lots of different ways, through making threats that they're going to hurt a survivor, that nobody's going to believe them, that they're going to harm the survivor or themselves by saying that they're going to commit suicide. They may tell them that if they try to leave them, then they're going to get the kids, or nobody, or they're going to, you know, fill in the blank with whatever abusers can say as part of their coercion to keep survivors in that. So we've been using this for a long time, right? We understand what this word means. Let's break it down. Let's look at the broad version of what coercion is. If you go to, so consent is to give someone permission for something to happen or an agreement to do something. So that is your word of the day for today. You're going to learn lots of different things about consent. What do y'all define as consent? Type in the chat box your definitions. If you were to have to give somebody a quick elevator pitch on what consent is, share it with the group so that we can see what y'all define it as. The presence of yes. Prior permission. As people are chatting in, we'll go to the next slide. So we're going to kind of lay this like historical precedence down. I'm going to let Bronwyn kind of give y'all the rundown of that as people are typing in. I think what's very clear here is that we are, when we're talking about consent, we're saying that somebody has to say yes, give permission, be in agreement. It needs to be clear. All of those things are very true. And so let's kind of break them down to why is this so murky? Why don't people understand what consent is, or why is it even being still talked about today?
Amanda, thank you so much for getting us all on the same page. And I think that we all feel really safe and comfortable with what Amanda has been talking to us about so far. We all love and know the power and control wheel. We know these definitions. We give presentations on these definitions. The safe and comfortable part of this presentation is now over. We are about to get a little bit uncomfortable, and we're going to ease into it by talking about some historical precedents that have gotten us to where we are today, where we all need to get just a little bit more woke. So first, let's talk about some common myths related to coercion and consent. We'll go through these pretty quickly. We have a lot of content today. One is that you only need consent for sex. Let's break this down. I have a daughter in preschool, and they are teaching them that they should get consent before they touch other classmates. I've learned in trainings I need to ask permission before I hug my clients. You know, this is a bigger thing. Consent is not just something for sex. It should be for all of our actions. What about if they don't say no, then it's okay? I think some of us are familiar with the concept of enthusiastic consent, and we'll talk about that more in a little bit. What about the idea that so long as they eventually say yes, it's okay? I think a lot of us are of an age where this was probably the standard practice. Somebody might really work on you and convince you to say yes. I think this conversation became part of our national scope when people really started looking at that song Santa Baby, and we all might feel different ways about that song. I kind of like it, but if you look at it literally, there is someone there being convinced to say yes, and we need to think, is that okay or not? What about the idea that you only need to ask once? Can someone change their mind? That used to be a groundbreaking idea, but we'll talk about the historical precedent for the concept of changing your mind about something as complicated as sex. I changed my mind at a restaurant about whether I want ketchup or not. I think sex is a way bigger deal than ketchup, although I know some of y'all ketchup people might disagree. Our last one on here, this is a big myth that people, especially women, like having their consent violated. I have a really great clip I'm going to show you in a second that breaks that down. But the idea that women want to be overpowered, if you look at popular books and now movies, like 50 Shades of Grey, kind of explore this idea. Hey, some people like to feel dominated in a relationship or in a sexual relationship, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's without their consent. So we kind of have to look at those two things differently. Another one we have on here, can clothes signify consent? I think the 80 people listening to my voice would tell you they know that clothes don't signify consent, but that as a society, this is absolutely something we are still talking about today. And Amanda has some good slides on that coming up. And this is another one, consent can be a buzzkill. I was just showing my, again, preschool daughter the movie Little Mermaid for the first time, and there's a charming song in there about how you shouldn't ask someone if they want to be kissed, you should just kiss them because maybe they sold their voice to a sea witch. It gets really complicated, but asking someone's permission can be sexy, and we'll talk about that a little bit more moving forward. So that was a quick 7 minutes in heaven for everybody on the phone. We had to get through these seven myths, but I promise you we're about to break them down and get even more uncomfortable. You want to raise your little hands if you're feeling uncomfortable in that chat box. Amanda will monitor it for me. Okay, the first one I want to talk about and break down a little more. Again, we're talking about historical precedents, some of them not so distant past. This is a case, y'all might have laughed when I said we need to talk about clothes signifying consent. This is a case from 2018. This is a case from last year. An Irish woman who was raped in a muddy alleyway. Can we get any more stereotypical than a muddy alleyway? Don't we all agree now that the muddy alleyway is where people get sexually assaulted? You know, nobody thinks that's controversial. This was a freaking muddy alleyway. But this woman was wearing a lacy thong. So the argument in court was, well, she must have been open to meeting someone and having sex because she was wearing a lacy thong. That was the defense lawyer's closing argument. And believe it or not, the accused rapist was acquitted of the crime, meaning found not guilty of this crime. So I think all of us who, you know, are against visible panty lines would agree that there's other reasons for wearing thong underwear than you wanted to invite a stranger to sexually assault you in a muddy alleyway. This is really disturbing, and it is just 1 year ago. Okay, we also have on here, and again, the last one had a hashtag connected to it. That hashtag was "This is not consent." If you are on social media platforms, you want to search that hashtag, it will pull up a lot of stories, not just of this Irish woman, but a lot of other stories of people sharing, you know, the circumstances around their sexual assault and how it did not imply consent. Just because they were drinking or flirty does not mean they were consenting. Here's another hashtag. What were you wearing? Where survivors all over the world have shared stories of the outfits they were wearing when they were sexually assaulted, trying to break down that myth that clothes indicate consent. Okay, I also want to talk about a myth of implied consent. So the idea was if you're wearing a thong or you're drunk or flirty, you must consent to sex, right? There's another very current conversation around the idea that if you're married to someone, you automatically consent to have sex with that person. There are 13 states here in the United States of America where they have different standards for sexual assault between strangers or acquaintances versus a married couple. These are actual real things that are happening. Some of them are actual laws on the books and others are case law. I'm going to give you just a few examples. If somebody's from one of these states and you want to, I don't list your example, and you want to follow up with me afterwards, I'm happy to send you more information. But the ones I found most egregious. In Oklahoma, there was a case where a woman was unconscious and her husband had sex with her. She accused him of sexual assault, and the court found, no, it's not sexual assault because you're married. In South Carolina, they have a statute on the books requiring, if you want to count it as sexual assault within a marriage, there better be a weapon, physical violence, and of an aggravated nature. In Ohio, there was a case where a man drugged his wife and had sex with her and was not found guilty of any crime. I think those are the most egregious, but I'm happy to share examples later from anyone who's from these other states on the list. This is really scary. Let's keep moving forward. Another group besides wives, where people have difficulty finding justice for sexual assaults, is sex workers. We have the term prostitute up here. It's used in a lot of the literature. I think the term sex worker is more appropriate, so I'm going to try to use that as we discuss this. But there are many examples of sex workers who have been sexually assaulted. In one study back in 2003, 93% of sex workers polled said they've been sexually assaulted in some way. 75% described that sexual assault as an act of rape. This is a very high percentage. What percentage do you think are getting convictions against their rapist? Very, very low. And the idea is that, okay, if you're willing to sell a sex act, well, then you're consenting to anyone, is really hard for our legal system to get around. This is a difficult one, one we could spend a lot longer talking about. Okay, so let's go to that other myth. Is anyone feeling uncomfortable yet? This will be a nice little break. But we have another myth here about how people, especially women, like to be overpowered. This is a term I've coined, the no-no, yes, kiss. Does anybody recognize this guy on the left just from his profile? I'll look for guesses in our conversation box. We'll see who's the first one to guess it as we play this video.
Isn't it customary to grant the condemned man his last request?
Somebody got it. Okay, what I want you to look for here is this is somebody who doesn't fall for Bond's charms, right? This is actually Pussy Galore, yeah. The famous name. So she's saying, you know, they're fighting. She's not interested in him. I'm going to have you look for the two beats of no, followed by the yes. And this is not the only example, but it's pretty much in every Bond movie. So look, she's still not into him. I think she's very actively not into him. Okay, here we go. Here's a no. She doesn't want to kiss him. No, she really doesn't want to kiss him. And you'll know when she changes her mind, because she loves getting overpowered, when she wraps him in her arms. There's the yes. Common myth in these movies. Goldfinger's not the only example of this. It's in lots of other movies, that force and struggle. Here's an iconic image that I think most of us have seen. We just had, I think, the 78th anniversary of Pearl Harbor. This is actually an image from VJ Day, Victory in Japan Day. I think we've been told a story about this image, but I want to tell you the real story behind this image. So on Victory in Japan Day, this was taken in Times Square. We have this part of the story is accurate. We have a returning naval employee here. Who is he kissing? This is not a nurse back from war. This is a dental hygienist who has come out of her Times Square office to see what's going on and be part of the celebration. She does not know this young man in the photo. He grabbed her and physically forced himself on her. Now, why don't you notice what's happening with his left arm? Maybe you hadn't paid a lot of attention before, but you know, I think if we had to draw this, we all would have drawn that left arm maybe in her hair or something. No, he's pulling that head down so she can kiss him. This woman's name is Greta Zimmer Friedman, the dental hygienist. And she's explained to me, or not to me, actually, I think it was an interview in Smithsonian Magazine. She says this was a very strong person. He held her very tightly. She doesn't feel sure about the kiss. She felt he was really celebrating. She said it was not a romantic event at all for her. She felt like he was indicating, thank God the war is over. She does not describe what happened to her as an act of assault. And I want to respect this person in the photo. I want to respect Ms. Friedman. She does not feel that way. But in our 2019 lens, looking back at her, she has quotes where she says, "It was not my choice to be kissed. This guy just came over and grabbed me." And I think we might interpret that differently now in this different lens. This is kind of a troublesome photo. We have some other iconic things happening in popular culture. I have another movie clip I'm going to show you. I know some of y'all hate black and white. This is a Academy Award-winning movie for Best Picture. I'm going to see who can guess it first in that chat box. But I'm going to play you a short clip between a husband and wife here. Oops. And you're going to discuss it with me afterwards. Remember, try to guess the movie in the chat box.
I don't want to upset you. If you will put things right when I'm not looking, we'll assume it did not happen.
But what? Gregory, what? Oh, please don't turn your back on me. What has happened?
You mean you don't know?
No, I...
Look.
Oh, we have a winner in our chat box. It is Gaslight. Kind of says it at the top there, guys.
Why has it been taken down?
Why indeed? Why was it taken down before? Will you please get it from wherever you've hidden it and put it back in its place?
But I haven't hidden it. I swear I haven't.
Best actress winner for that year, Ingrid Bergman.
Don't look at me like that. Someone else must have done it. No, don't reel. Please don't reel, Gregory. Don't shame me before your servants.
Please stop being hysterical.
Oh, do not tell me I'm hysterical.
Sit down and calm yourself before they come.
She seems really calm.
Bottom of this once and for all. Please come in, Elizabeth. Elizabeth, do you notice anything missing from this room?
Missing, sir? No, I don't think so, sir.
Look carefully around the walls. Well?
Well, there's a little picture missing, sir.
Exactly. Did you take it away?
No, sir.
Have you ever taken it down from where it belongs?
Oh, no, sir. Why ever should I?
Why, indeed. Elizabeth, you go to church, don't you?
To what, sir?
Church!
Yes, sir.
Please kiss this Bible as a solemn oath that you've told the truth. Thank you, Elizabeth. You may go now. And send Nancy in here at once.
Okay, you guys got the name of the movie. Yes, it is Gaslight. And what's happening in that movie is where we get the expression gaslighting, which is a very popular one to use now. We've all kind of brought that into our conversations, this idea of gaslighting. So I think the current definition of gaslighting would be any kind of psychological manipulation where you're seeking to sow seeds of doubt in a targeted individual or in members of that targeted group, making them question their own memory, question their own perception and their own sanity. This makes them easier to coerce into doing what you want. It's a very popular technique with abusers or someone grooming a sexual assault victim, this idea of gaslighting. That's a great movie. I don't want to spoil it for y'all. You've had 70 years to watch it, though, so I'm going to talk about it just a little bit. He's trying to make his rich wife seem crazy here so he can discover the treasures of her inheritance. And finally, there's a hero that comes in at the end. Of course, she can't save herself. It's 1944. And the man who comes in at the end says, "You're not going out of your mind. You are slowly and systematically being driven out of your mind." And I think that is an expression that could come out of any one of our mouths when we are speaking to some of our clients. You are not going out of your mind. You are slowly and systematically being driven out of your mind. You're being coerced by this technique, this really powerful technique of gaslighting. That is my last historical example because it brings us really nicely into my first rip from the headlines example, which is Dirty John. So we have five different case studies here. We're going to start with Dirty John and try to zip through these. And if you have questions and comments as we go, please enter them into the chat box. Amanda is monitoring that for us, and she'll bring some of those questions forward, and some of them we'll answer after the fact. So Dirty John started out as a podcast. I hope y'all know what podcasts are. It was an incredibly popular podcast, more so than most other podcasts. It was downloaded, gosh, I think something like a million times in the first 6 weeks. Oh, here it is. 10 million times in the first 6 weeks. That was way off. 10 million times in the first 6 weeks. So very popular, really caught the national attention. So those of you on here, maybe you weren't one of those 10 million people. For you, I'll summarize what happened here. This is a true life story of a successful interior designer named Deborah Newell. And she had been unlucky in love, or maybe lucky in love too many times. She had been married multiple times, was a real believer in love. How about that? So she's online dating and she meets a handsome man named John Meehan, and he seems to check all her boxes. He is attentive. He's available. He tells her he just got back from a year in Iraq with Doctors Without Borders. He's a very busy doctor. Right away, her family doesn't like him. And he starts working on isolating her from those naysayers, from that family. There's a lot of backlash when this story comes out. A lot of people who listened to the podcast blamed Deborah for what eventually happens to her. Those of y'all that weren't satisfied with my little description there, I'm going to try to show you a clip from the movie version, because this was so popular that it became a mini series on Bravo, and I think it just got put on Netflix. So if y'all don't have Bravo but you have Netflix, get excited. I just planned your holidays for you. So here's my favorite clip, which really shows. So Deborah is played by beautiful Connie Britton, and we have John played by very handsome Eric Bana, and they look a lot like their real-life counterparts. I'll show you a picture in a minute, but here, let's get this started. Ooh, that was tense. Well, let me get my slideshow back up, everybody, but the question I'm going to ask you first, Amanda posed as a live poll just now, what examples of emotional abuse were present? So maybe Amanda can show us some of those while I get that question back up here on the screen and go from there.
So the options that we have in the chat box, if you see, are isolation from children, controlling, name calling, gaslighting, or all of the above.
Those are all good. Here's that picture I promised you. The real life people, almost as good looking as Connie Britton and Eric Bana. This photo on the left is an interesting story. She was very involved in charity. This is some kind of like Key to Your Heart gala for heart disease. And she invited him to be her date. He shows up in scrubs and not appropriate attire for the event. But she thinks in her head, oh my gosh, he's such a busy doctor saving lives. Of course he wears scrubs. If anybody in here is a medical professional or knows a medical professional, I'd love you to guess in the chat box, what is the percentage that you would wear scrubs out of the office, let alone to a charity event? But she didn't know. So yeah, here's a 0%. Thank you. That's exactly right. She saw what he wanted her to see. So this podcast came out in 2017. It became a Bravo miniseries in 2018 and is now on Netflix now in 2019. So I don't want to spoil it for you. It's relatively new, but someone dies at the end of this story. And it's a lot of gaslighting. It's a lot of coercion. This idea that she felt forced to stay with him. He was so attentive. He would say, allow me to get your purse for you. Allow me to go deposit your checks for you. I'll pick up your mail for you. He did everything. He knew she took $30,000 out of their bank account because he was doing all of her banking for her. She felt, oh, wow, he really cares about me. He's doing all that for her. But maybe we can all see through that and see it was really part of control. So this first case study brings me to a really interesting newish law. In 2015, the United Kingdom actually criminalized these examples that you've given, the examples of coercion. This is not a crime across the world. It is starting to become criminalized in some jurisdictions of the United States, but the UK was the first to do it. And because they did it 4 years ago, we're now starting to get some data back about how it's going, the idea of criminalizing this. So the offense is actually called controlling or coercive behavior in an intimate or family relationship. It has a punishment of up to 5 years in jail or a fine or both. They break it down into different parts. And because it is kind of confusing, they list a lot of examples for people. But the main things I want you to know about this crime is that the people have to be in a relationship at the time, because that's part of it. With John and Deborah, they're in that relationship at the time. And the behavior, whatever the perpetrator's behavior does, has to have a serious effect on the victim. And the perpetrator needs to know that the behavior would have a serious effect on the victim. So definitely John Meehan would fit this crime in the UK. So if we look at him as like the example, then we've got a slam dunk case. But that's not what's happening across the UK. I told you they're getting some statistics back. They surveyed 33 different police forces around the United Kingdom. And they learned that in the 2 years after this law was passed, there were over 7,000 arrests for this law. But a little over 1,000 of those actually ended up with somebody being charged. There were only successful convictions in 235 of those cases. So it's a very dramatic drop off. I would say it's a similar drop off to prosecutions of sexual assault here in the United States. We might have a lot of reports, so definitely the most offenses, less reports, less arrests, less convictions, big drop off as each step goes by. So if we want to look at hypothetically prosecuting John Meehan under this law, the examples that you gave in the chat box are exactly the ones I have listed here as for things he did that would fit this crime. The Home Office in the United States, in the United Kingdom, I had to look it up. Like, what's a Home Office? It's kind of like our Department of the Interior. It's kind of like our Secretary of State. It's kind of like something we don't have here. But the Home Office listed examples for people of what would fall under this crime. This is about half of the examples. I picked these because they fell into the Dirty John story, but there's other examples. They said things that would humiliate or dehumanize the victim. Financial abuse would qualify. Threatening to reveal or publish private information. So some of those are things that are criminalized here in Texas, and some of them are not. If we look at family violence as it's defined under our Texas law, this is a much more narrow crime. We're really looking at physical violence or threats of physical violence or sexual assault. So really narrow here in Texas. What does this leave out? What does our Texas definition leave out? I'd love to see you all explain in the chat box. Well, definitely is leaving out coercion, right? So I'd be curious if any of y'all think that coercion should be illegal here in Texas. That's kind of the question I want to leave you with. Maybe makes you feel a little uncomfortable. I pulled my legal staff with that question 2 years ago after the podcast came out, and universally they did not like the idea of coercion being illegal here in Texas. but it is starting to happen in the United States. There's several jurisdictions that are copying this UK law, not Texas, but other jurisdictions, and we're going to kind of see what happens with those. Man, if you have anything to add, I'm about to move to our next story.
Nope. I've got a bunch of questions going in the chat box.
Oh, great. Thank you. Well, please answer Amanda's questions in that chat box, and we'll move on to our second case study. And this one's going to make you feel real weird. Here we go. We're going to talk about the Me Too movement and a CSUN sorry. So let's start by doing the giant Me Too movement briefly. And for that, I think I might ask Amanda to check me and chime in if I miss anything, because this is a lot to talk about, you know, in a 2-minute slide. But I have a picture of a woman here on the left. This is Tarana Burke. She is actually the person that came up with the MeToo movement, or the hashtag MeToo. She describes an event back in 1997, a million years ago. She was talking to a young 13-year-old African-American girl who was just recounting a story of a sexual assault. And Tarana Burke describes listening to that as feeling like she had nothing she could say to this poor girl, nothing she could say. She said even saying Me Too didn't feel like it would be comforting enough. And it was kind of from that conversation that this idea of Me Too was born, that perhaps there is some power in sharing with the victim that they're not alone, that this has happened to many of us. And people did start sharing those stories on the internet, but not back in 1997. They waited a little bit until, Trials and Charges. Alyssa Milano tweeted about it. I have the actual tweet over here on the right. She tweeted in 2017. Saying, you know, hey, if you have a story, you should chime in with your own hashtag MeToo story. And Alyssa Milano brought this up because of a conversation about Harvey Weinstein. That case is in the news this week because he is settling. It looks like he's going to settle a lawsuit with the board of directors of his production company. But I think you all know who he is. Harvey Weinstein, a very powerful producer in Hollywood and the owner of a production company. He has made or break the careers of many people, many, many starlets, if you want to use that word. But also a lot of people finally came forward and said that they had been sexually harassed or sexually assaulted by Harvey Weinstein. And that's kind of where the Me Too movement came out of. So it started as just a hashtag, but it really became the way of taking down this movie mogul. It also paved the way for another popular hashtag. We don't have time to talk about it, but the Time's Up, hashtag Time's Up, hashtag, which is really about inequality of pay between men and women. But it's something that crosses industry, and it's definitely present in the film industry. So the Time's Up movement, you see a lot of actors and actresses talking about it, but it's meant to be for any industry, and it came out of this movement as well. So knowing all that, whew, Amanda, did I get it all? That was a lot. I'm gonna take a breath.
Yeah, there's, you know, I think that if people have been following Tarana Burke's work in the Me Too movement, she's been very open about saying that the projection that and the attention that the Me Too movement has received since Alyssa Milano's tweet was unexpected for her. And people have latched on to this hashtag Me Too that is broader than what her original vision for Me Too and her organization was. But in helping for people to have a voice, where we saw at the beginning of this presentation, where hashtag what were you wearing, hashtag all the different hashtags that have been created. What we see in social media is a forum for survivors to have a voice and to feel safe enough to come forward and have a voice about victimizations against them. And it helps to give them community in that as well. And so although Toronto Burke didn't have this big vision for Me Too that it has exploded into, it really has been a platform for a lot of survivors that we've seen that allow them a space, a safe space to be able to use their voice.
Thank you, Amanda. So here's another part where we're going to leave the safe part of the presentation, where we all agree that we hate Harvey Weinstein and we love Toronto Burke, and that's all really clear. Let's move forward one slide, and we're going to talk about Aziz Ansari. You guys might recognize this actor from his role on Parks and Recreation, popular TV show. He's also a stand-up comedian. And I'm talking about him today because of an experience he had with a young woman who uses the pseudonym Grace. And Grace went back when, you know, she met Aziz Ansari one night. She was a big fan of his, and she went back to his apartment and had an experience that she wrote about on a blog called babe.net. Katie Way wrote Grace's story on babe.net. So in this story, she talks about how she went home with Aziz Ansari. She had a big crush on him. He wanted her to perform oral sex on him. She indicated she did not want to do that. That's not why she was there. I think really she would prefer to like start seeing him and develop a relationship with him. But he asked for this so consistently and repeatedly, and in a way where she felt intimidated by him, perhaps, you know, because she had a crush on him. He was a famous movie star. That she ended up performing oral sex on him and regretting it. She felt coerced to do it, and describes this in that to Katie Way, who then publishes it on babe.net. So after this comes out, there is a lot of backlash against the woman who's calling herself Grace, saying, how dare you tell this story about Aziz Ansari? How dare you describe this as a Me Too story? You were not sexually assaulted. You did this willingly, by choice, just tons of backlash. There was a good article describing the backlash on another blog called Vox.com. And just really kind of comparing this to the Harvey Weinstein story and really contrasting it to the Harvey Weinstein story. Because what happens with Harvey Weinstein, we have multiple people coming forward saying he's a dirtbag, right? And also all of the stories are, or almost all the stories are happening in a work environment. This is a potential employer, someone who could make or break their career. They're in the same industry. Grace does not say that this happened to anyone else. Grace does not say she thought she might work with Aziz Ansari or was looking at him for a job. She really did have a crush on him as a celebrity. So she got a lot of backlash. So I bring this up. This is kind of an uncomfortable one, but I bring it up because I think it's part of the conversation of, even if we all agree this might not fit our definition of sexual assault, is what happened to Grace okay? Do we think that we could ask for more of people like Aziz Ansari? Since then, Aziz Ansari has released a new comedy special. He addresses this issue right at the top. I think society as a group forgave him if they ever didn't like him. They're still on his side. He's definitely somebody who's like back in the good graces with the public. So I'd like you to think to yourself, if you want, but why is this different? Why is this different? And are you okay with what happened to Grace? Is that something you would want to have happen to you? So I think we can agree this doesn't fit the Texas definition of sexual assault. The Texas definition of sexual assault is very narrow. It's really just talking about penetration without consent, which is rape. But I do want to kind of break down for a second what's not on this slide, which is how Texas defines consent. Because we say, okay, Texas, rape is going to be penetration without consent. Well, what's consent? Texas does not define consent. Texas instead gives something like 12 examples of what it means to not have consent. it's a little unusual to define something by what it's not, but that's what we decided to do here in Texas. So I'm gonna tell you about those 12 examples. I'm gonna do it a little out of order. And I can send this to you if you wanna have it in front of you. It is in our Texas Penal Code. But the first, I'm gonna talk about some of them, like I said, out of order, but the first ones are pretty easy. We say, okay, well, it's without consent if you use physical force, right? Duh, we all agree on that. It's definitely without consent if you're physically forced to do it. Well, it would also be, we say, without consent if you threaten violence against another person. Like I say, if you don't have sex with me, I'm gonna hurt your children. Oh, yeah, that one, that's without consent, we all agree. Another real easy one that we all agree with is we say, if you compel the person to submit, you get them to say yes by using that force or threat of force. So all of those pretty straightforward. Now, Texas has another three that are slightly deeper examples of without consent, but again, ones I think we would all agree to. We say, what if the person's unconscious? If they're unconscious, it's without consent. Okay, we all agree to that. Here's another one. What if they're unaware that the sexual assault is occurring? Maybe somebody who is paralyzed or has taken some kind of medicine so they can't feel things happening. That would be without consent, right?
Right.
What if the accused assailant has given them some kind of pill or medicine to impair them? That'd be like a roofie. Well, that would be without consent, right?
Right.
So we all agree to that. The last four are the ones I really want to talk to you about for a second. I'm gonna say them all to you. These are the last four things Texas says are not consent. I'm gonna ask you a question. What do they have in common? So here they are. Number one, it's without consent if the actor is a public servant who's coercing the other person to participate. That might be like a police officer who pulled you over for speeding and then you have sex with them. Number two, the actor is a mental health service provider and you're their patient or former patient. Okay, so this is like if you're in a facility for people with a mental health issue and the person treating you, you have sex with them. We're saying that would be without consent. Number three, the actor is a clergyman and they're exploiting your emotional dependency on them. So that would be like if you go give confession to a priest and you end up having sex with them. And number four, if the actor is an employee of a facility where you're a resident, unless you're married. So this would be like you're in jail, something like that, and you're having sex with your jailer. What do these four have in common? Oh, y'all got it right away. These are all positions of power. Really good job. Good answer right away. So my question is, why do we list these four examples of someone who's in a position of power? Are there other examples of people that could have power over you? Why don't we instead do the hard work of defining what it means to have power over you? And if we did that, here's the hard question. Would we include a celebrity you have a crush on as somebody who has power over you? Or would we take a more narrow definition and maybe instead say, a movie mogul in your same industry is somebody who has power and control over you? That's kind of hard. Okay, so I have another little clip here. I'm just going to show a bit of it because if we're talking about this term of consent, and again, our definition in Texas is so weird, we can come back to this idea of consent as T. I think I hinted at it at the beginning. I think some of y'all have already seen this and are familiar with this concept. Oh, some of y'all love it. So I'm going to show it to you, just a little bit of it here. But wait, there's a twist.
If you're still struggling with consent, just imagine instead of initiating sex, you're making them a cup of tea. You say, hey, would you like a cup of tea? And they go, oh my God, fuck yes, I would fucking love a cup of tea. Thank you. Then you know they want a cup of tea. If you say, hey, would you like a cup of tea? And they're like, I'm not really sure. Then you could make them a cup of tea or not, but be aware they might not drink it. And if they don't drink it, then, and this is the important part, don't make them drink it. Just because you made it doesn't mean you are entitled to watch them drink it. And if they say no thank you, then don't make them tea at all. Just don't make them tea. Don't make them drink tea. Don't get annoyed at them for not wanting tea. They just don't want tea, okay? They might say, yes, please, that's kind of you. And then when the tea arrives, they actually don't want the tea at all. Sure, that's kind of annoying as you've gone to all the effort of making the tea, but they remain under no obligation to drink the tea. They did want tea, now they don't. Some people change their mind in the time that it takes to boil the kettle, brew the tea, and add the milk. And it's okay for people to change their mind. And you are still not entitled to watch them drink it. And if they're unconscious, don't make them tea. Unconscious people don't want tea. And they can't answer the question, do you want tea? Because they're unconscious. Okay, maybe they were conscious when you asked them if they wanted tea. And they said yes. But in the time it took you to boil the kettle, brew the tea, and add the milk, they are now unconscious. You should just put the tea down. Make sure the unconscious person is safe. And this is the important part again. Don't make them drink the tea. They said yes then, sure, but unconscious people don't want tea. If someone said yes to tea, started drinking it, and then passed out before they finished it, don't keep on pouring it down their throat. Take the tea away. Make sure they're safe, because unconscious people don't want tea. Trust me on this. If someone said yes to tea around your house last Saturday, that doesn't mean they want you to make them tea all the time. They don't want you to come around to their place unexpectedly and make them tea and force them to drink it, going, but you wanted tea last week. Or to wake up to find you pouring tea down their throat, going, but you wanted tea last night. But if you can understand how completely ludicrous it is to force people to have tea when they don't want tea, and you're able to understand when people don't want tea, then how hard is it to understand it when it comes to sex? Whether it's tea or sex, consent is everything. And on that note, I'm going to go make myself a cup of tea.
Okay, so now we've all seen the tea video. I know some of y'all love it. I saw somebody showed it to a group of high school kids. Watch that F-bomb. I've gotten in trouble for that with the high school kids. And I see somebody has suggested a video you like better than this one. And I might agree with you because while consent is like tea, and this is a really cool video, consent and sex is also not like tea. So let's talk about that for a second. How is sex not like tea? How is sex not like tea? Well, one example is that sex is way more high stakes than tea and way more loaded than tea. So while I'm trying to think of a good example of this, I think I have one. Like, Azizi Ansari offering that young woman tea, she probably would have taken it. Even if she hated tea, she would have been like, yes, I love it. If the Queen of England offered you some tea, you would probably take it and drink it. With sex, that happens a lot more. People might feel like, uh-oh, I better have sex with this person because I like them or I feel pressured to or whatever. So that's one way where sex is not like tea. It's more loaded, high stakes. Another way sex is not like tea is that we would like to check in more. If someone says, I'd like some tea, and they start drinking it, you go, oh, is it great? And they say yes, we're not going to ask them again. We're not going to say, is it still good? You want a little more? How about some more sugar? Is it great? It's great. More like this, more like that, stronger, weaker. Whereas with sex, that is a good idea to keep checking in with somebody, that they're still having a good time, that they're still liking what's going on. It's a good idea to kind of continue doing that. Whereas if you did that with tea, you'd be really creepy. So I think this tea video and the reasons why sex is not like tea can kind of give us more to think about when we contrast Azizi Ansari and Harvey Weinstein, and where we look at the holes in our Texas law. And I think we all agree there's a big hole in that Texas law, but how should we fill it? How could we fill it in a way that we feel comfortable with? Would it encompass the cases we think it should encompass? So this brings us to another case study. Here's another one that might make you feel a little bit uncomfortable. I think this is a movie clip, so I don't know why it's showing up. But this is the story of Michelle Carter and Conrad Roy. And this has been on Dateline, and we'll talk about all the ways it's ripped from the headlines. But it's a story that's commonly referred to as the suicide by text story. So I have a quick clip from my favorite, Inside Edition. So Inside Edition, not a great news source, but they do a good job of telling you a story very quickly. So we'll watch this quick clip from Inside Edition.
Michelle Carter weeps uncontrollably as she hears her fate.
This court, having reviewed the evidence, now finds you guilty on the indictment charging you with the involuntary manslaughter of the person Conrad Roy III.
There were audible gasps in the courtroom as a family member bowed his head in grief. There was no jury. Judge Lawrence Moniz rendered the verdict.
The actions taken by Ms. Carter constituted wanton and reckless conduct by her and serious disregard of the well-being of Mr. Roy.
Carter was found guilty of talking her boyfriend, Conrad Roy, into killing himself in 2014. His mother wiped away tears as she listened to the verdict. She was surrounded by family members who have endured more than a week of witness testimony. At the heart of the case, a series of phone calls and chilling text messages of then 17-year-old Michelle sent to him in the days leading up to his death. No more thinking. You need to just do it, she texted. The 18-year-old high school graduate was found dead in this black pickup truck in a parking lot outside Boston. A gas-fueled generator was in the back seat. Cause of death? Carbon monoxide poisoning. During the trial, four of Michelle Carter's girlfriends took the stand and read shocking text messages she sent them after Roy took his life.
His death was my fault. Like, honestly, I could have stopped him. I was on the phone, and he got out of the car because it was working, and he got scared, and I told him, get back in.
She instructs him to get back into the truck, which she has reason to know is or is becoming a toxic environment.
Prosecutor Katie Rayburn.
We fervently hope today's guilty verdict will bring some measure of justice to the friends and family of Conrad Roy.
Conrad Roy's father sobbed after the verdict came down.
This has been a very tough time for our family. And we'd like to just process this verdict.
Other family members said they were pleased with the judge's decision.
I can't believe it. I'm so excited that he found it in our favor.
Michelle Carter's lawyer had this to say.
I'm very disappointed with the outcome of the verdict.
It's a story that has touched a nerve across America, even landing on the cover of the New People magazine. Now with the guilty verdict, it has made legal history.
Her language was right in the moment when he said he had second thoughts about killing himself, and when he went ahead and killed himself, she egged him on. She pushed him, and that's why the words come.
Okay, so like I said, that's Inside Edition. They do it quick and dirty. There's a couple things I want to correct. I don't think either Michelle Carter or Conrad Roy would describe themselves as boyfriend, girlfriend. These young people from Massachusetts met once, when they were on separate family vacations in Florida. But after that, they continued to develop a friendship and relationship over the phone and over texting. Although my understanding is they never actually physically met again after that. So this happened in 2014. Why are we talking about it now? Because Michelle Carter appealed that decision. And it wasn't until this year that the highest court in Massachusetts made a decision on that appeal. In February 2019, they upheld the conviction. And this is the moment that is heard around the country. It is a groundbreaking moment for the concepts of criminal responsibility related to coercion. Never before in our country has somebody been convicted in this way for coercing someone to kill themselves when they were anywhere near them. Like this. This kind of brings to mind a story. I hope the people listening to me are old enough to remember Dr. Kevorkian and his stories of assisted suicides. He said, like, look, these people wanted me to help them. And whether you believe that they wanted him to help them or not, he was right there directing what was happening, whereas Michelle Carter was nowhere near Conrad Roy. So that's kind of what makes this different and another big story for us. If you're curious about the communication, there is tons of evidence, and we'll talk to you about some of the ways you can get your hands on it. But here are some of the big texts that I'll point out and wanted to share with you. if you look over here on the right, the last text, they have the timestamp. We're getting closer to the 8 o'clock hour where he actually called her on the phone and she admits that he said, I don't want to do this. And she said, she admits saying to him on the phone, she said to her girlfriends, the ones that testified, get back in the truck. So that's how we know she said it. She admitted to her friends. After that phone call's over is when this part happens where she says, did you delete all the messages? So I think that the prosecutor was able to make the argument like, look, that shows she has some knowledge that this is not okay because she's trying to get him to delete all the evidence. But it was too late at that point. He had already passed away. So her next text, the prosecutor was showing that she thinks he's deleted everything. And so she sends these sort of cover-up texts saying, are you there? You're scaring me. I love you. And at this point, we have evidence that she called his mother, again, trying to cover her tracks, saying, something's up. I'm scared. I love him. I'm scared for him. I don't know where he is. When she very well knew, as we can see from these texts, that she was at the he was at the Walmart parking lot. So if you want to see more about it, this really has kind of captured national attention. I mentioned this Dateline article, but there's also now a new documentary called I Love You Now Die, where they really go into more of the story. And it's a real compelling way of telling the story. Kind of in the first half, they talk more about Michelle Carter's point of view. So you really kind of are on her side. Then they drop the hammer in the second half and really tell you, about Conrad Roy's position through the prosecutors, and you can kind of make your decision after that. So I think this is interesting for us to talk about, one, because it's such a groundbreaking moment for coercion, but also it really relates to what we've been talking about in Texas and around the country, which is some of these cyberbullying cases. And let me first talk about this amazing man, Professor Evan Stark. He is the founding father of the concept of coercive control. I almost wanted to talk about this man back when we were talking about Dirty John. Professor Evan Stark has literally written the book. he is the author of a book called Coercive Control, How Men Entrap Women in Their Personal Life. I was able to learn from him a couple months ago through a webinar through the Battered Women's Justice Project, and it's just amazing. He's been consulted on that UK law. He's been consulted on some of our American jurisdictions that are trying to incorporate some of these laws. But in his book, he talks about how coercion isn't really to hurt someone. It's designed to subjugate and dominate them. In producing these hostage-like conditions. So think about that movie Gaslight. Think about Dirty John. Think about Michelle Carter and Conrad Roy. And then I also want you to look at, like I teased, some of these cyberbullying cases that we have. And specifically, I'm going to keep trying to move forward. Specifically, here in Texas, we have something we call David's Law. So I'm going to ask Amanda to chime back in and tell us briefly about David's Law and how coercion plays into cyberbullying.
Yeah, so David was a young man who lived in Alamo Heights, which is right outside of San Antonio. And a couple of years ago, David took his life after being tormented and bullied by some other teens at his school. And David's parents got really involved with looking into what laws had been created or could have protected their son, or what laws were there for the school district to have done more if they knew about this. And so two sessions ago now, there was a ton of laws that were changed around cyberbullying specifically and teachers' responsibilities, and even the parents of the students who are bullying, having put some responsibility back on them. So what happens when their student continues to bully, or when their child continues to bully another student? So there have been like some temporary injunctions that have been offered as a solution to hold those parents criminally responsible if their student if their child doesn't stop the cyberbullying. And so there were a ton of changes that were meant to address this issue. Because as we know, technology is always changing, and it's for our law to stay above the movement of how fast technology changes is really difficult. And so they did this like sweep in a bunch of laws to try to get ahead of it, so that as technology changes and as these types of cases like the Michelle Carter and Conrad Roy, as those types of cases are being heard, how is Texas able to kind of get ahead of the game and anticipate some of these so we can criminalize the behavior and it isn't so gray? There isn't such a gray area.
Yeah, what I think one cool thing about this law in Texas is that it is criminalizing behavior that happens in the cloud. So kind of like Michelle Carter and Conrad Roy, your bully doesn't need to be anywhere near you for them to be to fit this definition of cyberbullying in our Texas education code. So that's one way where we're kind of dipping our toe into exploring coercion in a really cool new way. There's lots of other stories like this around the country. Amanda and I have a whole presentation about that if you're interested, but also if you know a student that's experienced cyberbullying, we'd love that referral here at Texas Advocacy Project. We'd love to help that young person. But I need to move on. We have two more case studies to talk about, and the next one is Surviving R. Kelly. So this is a documentary that came out this year, in 2019. It was a groundbreaking documentary, universally acclaimed, talking about women emerging from the shadows, uniting their voices to share their stories about their experiences with abuse, predatory behavior, and pedophilia involving singer R. Kelly. So if you don't know who R. Kelly is, he is perhaps the most talented R&B singer ever. Has won many awards, wonderful songs, but for years, these rumors have kind of trailed him. And that's kind of boring. I don't want to talk about that necessarily. What I want to talk about are the women who are currently involved with R. Kelly. I think we'd all agree, being with a child, that's not as fun to talk about. But there are people that are currently involved with R. Kelly. I'm going to let Good Morning America explain it better than I can for you here in a quick clip. So you know about, I'm not going to show you part of the documentary. I want you to watch it, but this is just a quick clip from the morning show here.
The parents of a young woman who claimed their daughter is being held against her will by singer R. Kelly are speaking out this morning.
Yeah, they are concerned for their daughter's welfare, especially after a new docuseries was released. And as R. Kelly's lawyer is defending the singer from those claims of controlling and abusive behavior. ABC's Ariel Reshef joins us live with more. Ariel, good morning.
Good morning to you guys. Those parents are desperately pleading for their daughter to come home, claiming she's being held captive, but she says she's perfectly fine, and R. Kelly's attorney is swinging back. This morning, the family of a woman allegedly living with embattled singer R. Kelly speaking out, saying their daughter is being held against her will in Chicago.
And he knows how to manipulate young girls and make them feel like that's all they have.
21-year-old Jocelyn Savage on several occasions denying she's being held captive, even appearing without Kelly in this TMZ video from last summer.
People are saying that, I'm captive, I'm hostage. Well, obviously that's not true. I'm out here, enjoying life and doing my own things.
I need to get to my daughter because I know she's been coerced.
Kelly's attorney slamming the assertion Savage or any other woman is being forced to stay, tweeting, "Relax, America. Today, CPD visited R. Kelly at home and spoke to the two young ladies who live with him in private. Both told the police they are great, not hostages, not abused, not victims." Chicago PD confirming that welfare call, telling ABC News the women stated that they were not being held against their will and are both in good health and spirits. There was nothing out of the ordinary with the residents, and the officers closed the call as unfounded. Kelly, caught in a web of controversy, a number of women recently coming forward in the scathing Lifetime docuseries Surviving R. Kelly.
Can you describe the physical abuse?
Kelly's defense team, defiant in the face of allegations of controlling and abusive behavior.
The man was not operating a harem or a sex cult or holding people hostage or anything like that.
Now threatening legal action.
For defamation, because people shouldn't be able to do this to someone.
But a different picture from Jocelyn Savage's parents, desperate to reunite with their daughter.
We just want to sit there and hold you and make sure you're fine, make sure you're okay.
A-list artists are now voicing their concern after that docuseries.
It's okay to stop this one a little early. I don't need to hear from the A-list artists, but I think the question here that's most interesting to explore is, are these R. Kelly's current girlfriends, are they staying with him out of their own free will? I kind of want to talk about free will. They say they are, but can coercion override free will? This is kind of goes back to Dirty John and Michelle Carter, Conrad Roy, gaslighting, all of it. But so these women that are with him right now, there's two of them. They're either 21 or 22 or 23, so they're grown women. They did an interview with Gayle King, Oprah's best friend, where she had said, hey, come without R. Kelly, I'll interview you, you can tell your side of the story. We know from behind the scenes, R. Kelly actually came with them. And if you watch that video, and Gayle King has said, every time she asked them a question about, is this your own free will, are you with him willingly, R. Kelly off screen would clear his throat. Just last month, she told more about the behind the scenes story of what happened. So if you're interested in that, check it out. But I want to kind of get into something deeper here a little bit. I know we're running out of time, but the idea of this word seduction. So there's some really cool research and the research study talks about scripts. Scripts meaning, and they have a long definition for them, but in my uneducated terminology, script is kind of the story we tell ourselves about what happened. So if we talk about, the best way to explain this is, let's say that you're in a muddy alleyway and someone forces you to have sex with them. It'd be really easy for you to say, like, oh my gosh, I was raped, because that's a very stereotypical script. But if instead of being in a dark alleyway, let's say it was your anniversary, 1 year of dating, and they took you to a fancy restaurant and they bought you a lobster dinner and then gave you lots to drink, even though you were like, I'm done drinking, they gave you more to drink, and then ended up having sexual intercourse with you, and you're like, that was against my will, or was it? That one might be harder for people to identify because it doesn't fit the traditional script. In fact, that might fit the traditional script of seduction. We think, oh, even though I knew I didn't want to have sex with him, maybe we'd never have sex yet, but because it was prom, or because it was our anniversary, because it was so neat, maybe I was seduced. I think this kind of goes back to our VJ Day photo of Ms. Friedman. If everyone's saying, oh, of course you were carried away, it was so romantic, this is a hero, it didn't fit her traditional script at the time of a forced kiss. So the problem with these scripts, the problem in society, is a problem for both men and women. Because if we have these traditional scripts that men need to be the initiator of sexual activity, then men are going to be more likely to be like a Cece Ansari and try to initiate over and over again because they think that's what they're supposed to do. Also, if we have this traditional script or myth that women are the gatekeeper of sexual activity, that women say no, 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 like in Santa Baby, the song, then again, men are more likely to want to ask you over and over again and might delve into what we could think of as coercion because they think you're just saying no because you feel like you have to. That no, no, yes story from the James Bond movie. We also have a myth, a traditional script, that men have a higher sex drive And again, that's going to lead to some of these situations where men think, well, of course she's saying no because she just isn't as into sex as me. Of course I have to provoke her and coerce her. So all of these can be real problems, these traditional scripts. So I just want to kind of leave you with that to think about as we move into our very last case study. So I have a couple other ripped from the headline stories here. We have a documentary on the left, Abducted in Plain Sight. It was a documentary back in 2017, but it got onto Netflix this year. That is a cuckoo banana story if you want to watch it. Please do. I'll talk more about it in a second. But on the right, we have another show, again from this year, a documentary called Leaving Neverland that looks at two grown men, Wade Robson and James Safechuck, who alleged that they were sexually abused as children by Michael Jackson and the effect on their families. So I bring both of these up because after they came out, there was a huge backlash against the parents of the victim in both of these stories. Against both of them. So really here, I think we're all kind of familiar with the Michael Jackson story. So the one I want to focus on, just to kind of by way of giving you a little more explanation, is Abducted in Plain Sight. I'm going to show you just a little clip about it, just in case you've been under a rock and haven't heard about this one.
Mr. Virchow had such an effervescent, wonderful personality. We became very good friends.
He was so engaged with the kids, too. I mean, he really was fun. And
he could give me a great feeling about myself. I was attracted to him.
Jan Broberg and Robert Birchtold had an unnatural relationship.
I loved him as deeply as I've ever loved anyone.
My brother was always a sexual pervert. He always did like his little girls.
Birchtold said, I want to take Jan out horseback riding. When she didn't come home, I was a little nervous.
It was a nationwide search.
Jan went with me voluntarily. They bring in aliens and mind washing.
The mission was that I was to have a child that would save the alien planet by the time I turned 16. The Brobergs say the attacks still continue.
There's no way to trap for me.
His number one goal was to seduce Jan Broberg. And if he had to destroy the family, he would do it.
There'll never be anybody for me but Jan. Never.
Oh, what a creep. So the reason this became such a headline-making documentary, spoiler alert, everyone, is not only did this rapist sexually assault this young woman, he also had sex with both her mom and her dad. So you can see why this was pretty sensational. So after these two documentaries came out, Abducted in Plain Sight and Leaving Neverland, like I said, a lot of blame on the parents. So where I want to get you uncomfortable, if you're not already uncomfortable by that creep, is I want you to ask yourself, who do you blame more for what happened in these stories, the rapist or the parents? I want you to think about that for a second. And I want to kind of talk about the idea that grooming a victim isn't just about grooming this child victim, but it also involves a seduction of the parents. So let me share with you in the last few minutes of my presentation, Oprah Winfrey had a show on this Leaving Neverland documentary, and she had a psychologist come on and talk about the five steps that a perpetrator uses to groom their victim. And it's not just that child victim. It's the whole family. And if you look at these steps, the first three happen before you even know something weird is going on. It's those last three where they're really able to be effective and get something done. But they're already part of the family at that point. In the Michael Jackson story, the parents said they felt like he was an older child in their family. And you can imagine what the Abducted in Plain Sight parents would say. So looking at this and ask yourself, who do you blame more, I think is interesting because we're really looking at those, again, those concepts of coercion and consent. And are the parents really, are they a, you know, an assistant to the perpetrator, or are they also a coerced victim? That's kind of the weird thing there. So if I haven't kind of blown your minds yet here, like I've blown my own or made you feel uncomfortable, I have to kind of wrap it up and not take much more of your time. So what I really want you to kind of walk away from, and again, I'm going to go back to our father of the term of coercion, Evan Stark, and he says, look, you know, Amanda showed you that power and control wheel. He says, look, that power and control wheel, we really need to think more about that, because coercion is more important to be looking for than bruises. He said, if you can find a victim who is scared of their perpetrator, who is doing everything they're told, that person is more at risk than the victim that comes to you with a black eye. So please, you know, don't let this be the last you think about it. Let's think about these topics more. And if you want to get in touch with us, we would just really love to hear from you. So Amanda and I have our contact information there. And I'm going to have to turn it back over to my friends at TASA.
Thank you so much. Wow, such a great topic. I'm sure you could probably talk for at least a couple more hours on everything.
it is a race.
Thank you everybody for joining us today. You will, as soon as you log out or in a couple of hours, receive an automatically generated email that has an evaluation link. We would love to have your feedback. We share those with the presenters, but also it gives us feedback on other topics you might be interested in for future webinars. And we're actively trying to fill out our calendar for 2020. So any ideas are very graciously accepted. And again, if you have any questions, please get in touch with the presenters or get in touch with TASA. We'd love to hear from you. We have one more webinar before we end the year, again, about developing a strategic development plan. Would love to have you join us. That's it, everybody. Thanks again. Take care.
Thank you, everyone.